Listening Library presents Who Was Lucille Ball? By Pam Pollack and Meg Belviso. Read for you by Tara Sands. Who Was Lucille Ball? In the spring of 1952, cities across America experienced a mysterious drop in the water pressure every week between 9:30 and 9:35 p.m. In New York City, it seemed impossible to get a taxi on a Monday night. All the cabbies were off duty. And in Chicago, a department store changed its business hours because it seemed like no one was shopping on Monday nights anymore. What was going on? It turned out that it was all related to a TV show, a half-hour comedy. On Monday nights, Americans from coast to coast rushed through their dinner. Kids finished their homework as fast as they could. By 9 o'clock, everyone gathered in front of their televisions and waited. In the 1950s, TVs took a while to warm up. Finally, a big heart appeared against a satin background. The theme song of I Love Lucy began, and America was watching. It turned out that the viewers across the country were all waiting for the show to be over before using the bathroom. Toilets all flushing at the same time had caused the water pressure to drop throughout one city. No one wanted to miss a minute of Lucy. Lucille Ball, the star of the show, was the most beloved woman on television. Whatever trouble she was in, Lucy could make it seem like the funniest thing anyone had ever seen. All over the country, people couldn't stop laughing. How did Lucille Ball become one of America's first big TV stars? It wasn't easy. She worked for years in Hollywood, making movies before she got a chance to show TV viewers how funny she could be. But she wasn't afraid of hard work. And she wasn't afraid to take a pie in the face, or fill her pockets with eggs, or her mouth with chocolates. All to make people laugh. I Love Lucy was the name of her show. And how could you not? Chapter 1. Lucy Ball. Lucille Desiree Ball was born in Jamestown, New York, on August 6, 1911. Although she always preferred Lucille, her family nicknamed her Lucy Ball, and the world came to know and love her as Lucy. Her father, Henry, worked for Bell Telephone, putting up phone lines all over the country. So he, Lucy, and Lucy's mother, Desiree, moved around a lot. When Lucy was three and her mother was pregnant, Henry died of typhoid fever. Lucy and her mother, who was known as Dee Dee, moved in with Dee Dee's parents, Frederick and Flora Bell Hunt. The family lived in Celeron, New York, not far from Jamestown. There, Lucy's brother, Fred Ball, was born in 1915. Other relatives came to live at the house in Celeron, too, including Lucy's young cousin, Cleo. Grandpa Fred took Lucy to the theater to see the live vaudeville shows in Jamestown on Saturdays, and to the silent flickers, movies, shown outside in the park during the summer months. Vaudeville. From the 1880s through the 1930s, the most popular form of live entertainment in the United States was vaudeville. Each show was made up of many different performers. The stage acts might include singers, dancers, jugglers, acrobats, or even trained animals. Some of the most popular performers were also the funniest. Favorite comedians like Buster Keaton and Charlie Chaplin started out in vaudeville and went on to become stars of early movies. Even though she was still very young, Lucy was a responsible girl. After her grandmother died, she looked after her younger cousins. From the time she was 10, she took any odd job she could find. She sold hot dogs at the local boardwalk, and she worked at an ice cream shop until she was fired for always forgetting to put the banana in the banana split. By the time she was a teenager, Lucy was very independent. She was the first girl in town to bob, or cut short, her hair, which was very shocking in the early 1920s. She was a flapper, a slang word for the rebellious young women who wore makeup and short skirts. Lucy liked it when people in town talked about her. She loved the attention. What she really wanted was to be on stage like the performers in the vaudeville acts or in the flickers. There weren't a lot of ways to become famous in Celeron, so Lucy started to think about where else she might follow her dream. New York City wasn't that far away. Many of the theaters in America were right there on Broadway. Lucy had never really tried to act before. She couldn't sing or dance, but she thought she could learn. If she just worked hard enough, Lucy was sure she could become a star. And she had never been afraid of hard work. By age 15, Lucy had convinced her mother to let her attend acting school in New York City. Even though money was tight, Dee Dee agreed to pay for Lucy to go for a 6-week trial period. Lucy did her best at the school, but her teachers didn't think she had any talent. At the end of the 6 weeks, the school sent Lucy home with a note telling Dee Dee that she was wasting her money. They said Lucy would never be an actress. But Lucy didn't care what the school thought. If they didn't want her, she would make it in New York on her own. Chapter 2. Ain't Meant for Show Business. Over the next 7 years, Lucy traveled back and forth between New York City and Celeron. She tried out for any acting job she could find, but she rarely got cast. Not even when she briefly changed her name to the more glamorous Diane Belmont, and later simply to Montana. And then it seemed as if her luck was changing. Lucy got a job in a Broadway show. She would be in the chorus. That meant she was one of a dozen girls who sang and danced together behind the star of the show. But after only 2 rehearsals, the stage manager fired her. "It's no use, Montana," he told her. "Go home. You ain't meant for show business." Lucy earned money selling makeup at drugstores and modeling in department stores. She tried on outfits for wealthy shoppers. If the customers liked how they looked on Lucy, they might try the clothes on themselves. In the spring of 1933, she became a Chesterfield girl, a model in the advertisements for Chesterfield cigarettes. Lucy was pictured in a skirt that showed off her long legs on billboards, posters, and window displays. She often walked around town looking for her face on Chesterfield billboards. When she found one, she would stand in front of it, hoping someone would recognize her. Nobody ever did. Lucy didn't yet have the eye-catching red hair she would later be famous for. She was just another blonde girl on the crowded New York City sidewalks. Lucy was now 22. She had been trying to get work as an actress for 7 years. She wondered if she would ever break into show business. One morning, as Lucy took a walk down Broadway, she bumped into Sylvia Hallow. Sylvia was an agent. She hired a lot of pretty girls and dancers for New York nightclub shows, and also for movies. Sylvia was thrilled to run into Lucy. She had just hired a group of actresses to work at Goldwyn Studios in Hollywood. One of the young women had dropped out at the last minute, so Sylvia was looking to replace her. The girls were leaving on Saturday, and there was no time for a screen test. Would Lucy be willing to leave quickly for California? Of course she would. Sylvia gave Lucy a coat, a hat, and a dress. She promised her that if the job with Samuel Goldwyn, the head of the studio, didn't work out, she could come back to New York. When Lucy boarded the 20th Century Limited train at Grand Central Terminal at the end of the week, she was sure she had finally gotten her lucky break. Chapter 3. Queen of the Bees. when Lucy and the other young women from New York arrived in Hollywood. They were lined up, wearing bathing suits, by Samuel Goldwyn. He wanted to see if the actresses...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.